Hey, Jim Bergman with measureQuick. Wanted to go over some really cool new stuff we built out into the software. And it's probably one of the biggest heating updates that we've ever done. And so first thing I want to talk about a little bit is that, you know, there's a lot of tools required to actually do a gas furnace the right way. And not everybody has all those tools. So what I wanted to do is sort of set up measureQuick so we could do a good, better, best. Meaning that if you have all the tools, you can do a really top end furnace diagnostic and get everything set up 100% to manufacturer's specifications. But if you don't own things like a combustion analyzer, you can still use measureQuick to get things in the ballpark or better. So I'm gonna go over this little good, better, best and give you guys an idea of how to walk through this. So right now what I have measureQuick set up for is a good testing. And you'll see that on the grid here we have our inches of water column, we have our gas pressure coming in, we have our manifold pressure, we have our induced draft pressure, we have our total external static pressure, supply air, dry bulb, and wet bulb, supply air, dry bulb, and return air, dry bulb, and then all our calculations. So up here I've got a yellow jacket psychrometer that's measuring my supply air temperature. I've got down here a yellow jacket psychrometer measuring our return air temperature, and a yellow jacket psychrometer, or manometer, excuse me, measuring my induced draft pressure. And then I've got a manometer here measuring my input pressure and a manometer here measuring my manifold pressure. Now, you look at this, you go, okay, well, you got four, actually, and one more manometer up here measuring supply air static. So if you look at this closely, you go, well, one, two, three, four, five manometers. Yeah, that's a lot of manometers. But if you set everything up ahead of time, we're not moving any manometers around. This makes the gas heating workflow go really, really fast. And we can see everything all at once live on our screen, so we can really quickly make an assessment and see what's going on. Down here at the bottom of the screen on the grid view, you'll see this test setup. And this is where you can select if you have performing a combustion analysis or in doing ambient CO. I'll just show you what that looks like. You can see that greatly extends your screen out for all the combustion analysis readings. So again, we can see everything at once. I'm gonna go back and turn that back off, like you don't have a combustion analyzer, and you can see it goes back to here. So let's go ahead and we're gonna just dial in the manifold pressure on the furnace. So you can see we're at 3.97 inches, which the manufacturer calls for 3.5, so we're a little bit overfired. And I'm gonna go ahead and dial this in here. And a high manifold pressure, we're gonna get down to 3.5 inches. So what we're watching is the second one in display. You can see it just went green now that we're at 3.73. And we'll just let this set for a second, make sure it's gonna come down. 3.71, 3.7. We'll get it right into 3.5. And you can actually hear the gas pressure coming down in the furnace. And this is plus or minus 2% of rated. So you wanna be within that as close as we can get. And that's gonna lower our stack temperature. So right now we're at 3.50, went a little too far. 3.46. And, you know, I dial it in as close as I can just because we have digital tools and we can. So we're at 3.48, and you can see now our BTU input's at 60,128, 48,000 output, return static 0.66, supply static 0.38. So our total external static's 1.04, which is high static for this furnace. And that's because we have a dirty filter in here. It's sort of done on purpose. If you tap on any one of these, it'll tell you what that reading means and what you need to look for. In this case, it'll tell you to check your filter and make sure that it's not dirty. And but you can see the gas pressure checked off, inlet pressure checked off, supply air, dry bulb, all those measurements are in, and we're dialed in really quickly. So this is a great workflow. If you want to do it in a test, you can obviously go in and do this in a full test, but I wanted to show you in this workflow. So this is good. Getting the manifold pressure set, we at least know we're within a reasonable range for what the manufacturer expects. So let's do the next one and we'll go over to clocking the gas meter. All right, so I'm in a workflow now, and in the visual inspection, a lot of people had questions about, well, what do I actually need to look at when I'm looking at the thermostat or the setback program, or what does plug wire penetration mean? So now if you click the view button on here, it's gonna tell you what to look at on the thermostat. So we're gonna make sure it's securely mounted and level. Modern thermostats is for aesthetics, mercury thermostats is for calibration. Confirm the setback program, make sure that it's right, and for the homeowner's comfort and efficiency preferences. Check the wall opening behind the thermostat, so we're gonna make sure that that's plugged, usually with thumb gum, to make sure that we don't have humidity coming from behind the wall or or air coming from behind the wall that's going to influence the thermostat readings. And then if it's an older mercury thermostat, we should recommend a replacement because we want to get mercury out of homes, and we want to make sure that it doesn't ever get damaged, and it'll also give them a little bit better performance on their system. So every one of these has a what to inspect. You can open and close it if you want to close it. If you want to see what to inspect on the electrical system, it's there. Any one of these on the visual inspection checklist. They're a lot more detailed now, so you can make sure that you're getting all the checks in that you need to do. So now we've gone ahead and set the manufacturer's manifold pressure, 3.5 inches. We got that set. And that's good. And like I said, it gets you into the range. But let's now go back and let's clock the meter. So I'm going to go into my pressure measurements for a minute. You can still see I'm in at 3.5 inches of gas pressure. I'm going to capture those measurements. And now I'm going to go to clock the meter. So you have an opportunity here to either clock the meter or skip clocking the meter. Because sometimes you can't get into it, you can't get to the meter, or you're in a multi-family home where it's sublet, or you may not have a meter you can actually read. There could be some reasons, but in this case, we're going to clock it. Now, I've already gone ahead and set my average heat content of fuel at 1060, which is for Ohio. I'm going to hit capture manifold pressure, and then we're going to come around here and we're going to clock the meter. So typically, come around here all the way so you can get a look at the meter here. Typically what I do is wait till the meter gets all the way to the top, just because it's easier to clock there. And I'm going to go ahead, and when it gets to the top, I'm going to hit start on my app. So start, and we're going to start clocking that meter. So that's got to go around in MeasureQuick. You can see down here, I have it set up the meter dial, half cubic foot dial, which is this dial right here. And I have it set up for 2 full revolutions. Because if you watch this, you'll see it slow down sometimes and speed up sometimes. That's pretty normal on these. It's just the way the mechanics of the meter work. And so you want to give it 2 full rotations before you clock the meter. So if you want even more accuracy, you can go to the higher cubic foot dial, but it takes longer for it to go around. In this case here, this is a 2 cubic foot dial. So it would take a while to go around. The half cubic foot dial gives us a really good resolution as long as we let it go around for 2 full rotations. So we got about another 30 seconds to go here. And when it gets to the top there, we're gonna hit stop. And then we'll see what to set the manifold pressure at. So there's stop. And you can now see that MeasureQuick's telling us to set the current manifold pressure to the target. So based upon the heat content of gas and on here, you can see that the live manifold pressure is at 3.48. So these do drift a tiny bit, the regulators drift, but it's telling us to set it to 3.36. And that's because the heat content of the gas in Ohio is higher than 1,000 BTUs, which is what the manufacturer designed the furnace for. So I need to lower that gas pressure down. And you can see in MeasureQuick here, it's telling us to set it to the target pressure. So you can see my live manifold pressure is 3.48. I'm going to go to the high fire regulator on this, and I'm going to dial that back down to 3.36. Again, I got a little too far on there, so I'll take it back up. And you can see when it gets into range, it tells you you can capture it. So I'm going to take it up just a tiny bit more and let it stabilize for just a minute. Looks like it's going to hold there at 3.32, which is 59,871 BTUs of heat input, and I'm going to capture my final manifold pressure and then hit continue. So let's go back, let's look at our grid view for a minute. You can see now that our 3.35 inches of water column is in range. We're still running high static, but this is a better setup now because that furnace was fairly significantly overfired for the amount of heat that we have, heat content of gas that we have here in Ohio. So getting that furnace fired properly is going to allow it to last a lot longer time. Overfiring is what kills furnaces, what kills heat exchangers. So this high static pressure, which normally means low airflow, in combination with a overfiring, is a bad situation for the furnace. So you can see that by getting this set up properly now, by clocking that meter, this is a lot better for the appliance. So now I'm going to show you a couple other things to measure quick. Let's go to best for a minute here. I'm going to go to test setup. And I'm going to perform a combustion analysis that also allows us to use the combustion analyzer to measure ambient CO. You can see that that significantly enhances the amount of data that's on my grid view screen here. If I view my current diagnostics, you can see it's looking for a CO air free measurement, an ambient CO, and I have high total external static pressure on that. So let's go ahead and start the analyzer. I already warmed the analyzer up and I connected it to measureQuick. So you want to have it on this screen, on this home screen, when you go to connect it, and that'll give you the best results overall with the interface. I'm going to go ahead and start the analyzer. And I've got two holes drilled in the stack here. We're using the NCI version of the analyzer, which has got separate drafts. So I can measure draft here, and I'm going to go ahead and move my probe here, and I can get my stack temperature and my gas readings there. So these are going to take a few minutes to come in, and not all of them will show right away until the analyzer starts to get flue gas and sample in there. So things like your excess air, things you can see are starting to calculate now. So now you can see in my whole screen here, I can look at not only my inlet pressures and my delta T's airflow, but I also get my O2, which is high right now, my stack temperature, which is low right now, CO's checked off, which is great, 17 parts per million, my CO air freeze 33, excess air at 86, still coming down, dew point of our flue gas or CO2, outdoor air temperature, which is blank because we haven't measured that, our draft, our efficiency, 85%, which is actually running high on this furnace, and then our BTU in or BTU out. So you can see this is in this two blanks here for NO and NOx. That's because this analyzer is not equipped with a NOx sensor in it, so those two are blank on there. You can also see at the top of the screen that this is stabilizing right now. So we're looking at our CO, our O2, and our stack temperature to make sure that they're all stable. So if I click on that stabilizing and then click more, I can see right now my CO and my O2 are stable, but it's just waiting for my stack temperature to come up in line and get stable. So I'm gonna give that a few more minutes, and then this is gonna give us a full combustion diagnostics. So now everything is stable on the furnace. You can see we can view the diagnostics, and you can see it's looking for an ambient CO reading. That's because I'm in a project. It does have a low stack temperature. So, and actually this is the one I keep telling you gotta call Goodman on. I haven't called him on, because the stack temperature on this is low. If we click on that more button, it's gonna tell us, hey, here's symptoms of a low stack temperature, too much primary air, maybe too much secondary air, or here's some third problems. It could be a bad heat exchanger. A lot to read there, but you can see we go into great detail on the diagnostics. We also got a high O2. So high O2 and low stack temperature together probably are running hand in hand. And then we got, again, the high static pressure on the diagnostics. You can see everything here is now easy to see on one screen. You can also start and stop the combustion analyzer from this screen. So if I want to stop the analyzer, I can. Or if I hit this plus combustion, I can go right into my project. So I can see all my readings here. I can capture my measurements and then go to the next step in my project when I'm ready. So a lot of updates here that allow the, again, that good, better, best. Good, setting the manifold pressure. Better, clocking the meter, getting the input and setting the manifold pressure by the input of the furnace, which it's rated for. And then best is going through and doing a full combustion analysis to make sure that the appliance is not only efficient, but more importantly, that it's safe. So again, this allows us to meet you where you're at, but it also allows you to upgrade at any time and really get the most out of measureQuick.